So in last this class, we have discussed on how to capture the image using something called as a CCD sensor, as well as we have observed that something of this nature happens when we are looking at the image capturing devices for the digital cameras and all. So this is primarily the sensor where the electron potential will be shifted from one point to another based on the gate voltage being carried out. Okay, so that is what we have discussed. Now, today's discussion primarily, and also we have seen an advancement on that CCD by with respect to CMOS sensor, where the amplifier will be installed or will be integrated within the chip itself. So that saves a lot of the chip size, as well as the efficiency of the sensor itself is improved a lot. So in that light of that, let us discuss today's topic, which is basically the after the capturing of image, what will happen to the image. I guess that will be useful for many of you who are doing the projects on the robotics and like the J component project. Many of you are capturing image or streaming the live videos and all. So I guess many of you might be useful on this aspect, because this is a segment, this image processing as a subject, as you many of you are doing this time around. So this is a separate subject altogether. So I cannot really go on discussing the complete details of image processing in this case, but at least to give you an idea about the basic term and the process involved with the image processing. So that is what the idea is. So ideally it is the process or technique to enhance the raw images. Because now the pixel, if you remember that we had some 4x4 pixel, and each pixel is capturing some kind of a voltage element, okay, some value. So that is basically the raw image. So we have to enhance the raw image received from the cameras or the sensors. So this is basically the idea behind image processing. Now it can be analog or digital, and naturally digital systems are always better compared to analog with respect to noise immunities and all, and the clarity of the photos and all. So that's why in digital image processing is naturally the choice of one. Okay? So that's why the image processing is so much important for many of the systems for that matter. So let us directly go to, this is not required in fact. The important part is from this part, that why we are going for image processing. So primarily the purpose of image processing is all about sensing and digitalizing the image data. That we have discussed last day, that when the photons are emitting those electrons and it is being shifted from one point to another using the bucket brigade analogy and all. So basically after the capturing of this voltage, you have to convert that to something like a sample, an A to D conversion and some digital data that is required. So that is what the idea is. Operations like signal conversion and image storage is also, image storage are not visible. So in the previous case, in this case, we are trying to make sure that how the image will be stored, because the lesser space it will take, the better it is, because we will accumulate more and more images. That's as simple as that. So that is a part of the processing itself. Second part is the image sharpening and restoration. Just like I told you that they are all raw images. So it will require definitely some kind of a polishing, if you call it. And that is what the idea behind image sharpening and restoring. All this process will lead to some four basic ideas. So that's why the prelude to this is this. Then we have image retrieval, where the image should be retrieved back by some means. Then measurement of patterns. Patterns means this is where the edge detection and all those process comes in, where basically we are trying to segregate out, okay, maybe this remote from the background of the image. Okay, so a robot, suppose you consider from a manipulator's point of view, it has to go and pick up this element. Now, to identify this element present on a rack or on a conveyor belt, it needs to figure out that the rest of the things or the rest of the background is separate and this element is to be picked up. So that is where this measurement of pattern comes in. Okay, so we'll see that one by one. And image recognition, distinguish the object in an image. So that is what the idea behind the image processing is. And primarily, these are the four techniques that we are going to discuss. This is as per the syllabus that suggests us to brief on it. So one is the image data reduction, how the captured image, okay, made sure that the data is reduced or the data volume is reduced. Because this is where some of the techniques will come in. This is some techniques will come handy here. Then we have a segmentation called a process of segmentation. Then we have a feature extraction, and the last one is the object recognition. Okay. We'll see how much we can finish up today itself. Otherwise, we'll finish it off on Friday. I'll try to finish it off as much as possible. So the first thing first is something called as the image storage, we call it. Okay. So when the raw image comes over, when the raw image will come over to the sensor, the first thing that should be done, okay, the first thing that needs to be done is called as the frame grabbing or storing in an array. Now, if you can closely observe, if remember the last day when we were discussing the CMOS or the CCD sensor, this I00 or I01 is basically indicating the coordinate or the position of the pixel. Okay, the element of the within the pixel, this is the I00 location. There, the intensity of light, intensity, whatever it is, that is given by this I00. Okay, so like that, it will go on until this n minus 1 to m minus 1. So n and m is nothing but something like, if you consider a 128 cross 128 figure or a 520 cross 512 cross 512 figure. Okay, like that. So it's a dimension of the figure. So the whatever it is, that basically is indicating the pixel size. So okay, so this is what the array is, and this is given by something called as a frame grabbing, as a technical term we call it, and this is how we are arranging it. This is very important because as we go along, you will observe that this forms the basis of all our discussion. So this is, as a technical term goes, it's called as frame grabbing. Now the problem is, this frame that you are looking at, or the element that you are looking at in this array, it will be all of raw images. It will not be a very polished one, because the noise or the granular noise will be there. To reduce that, or to make this thing work, what we are going to do is something called as masking. Again, details of this, I guess you will be taught in your image processing, but just to brief on this again. So masking is nothing but doing something like a noise reduction. So you can observe that this equation, if I consider, so this left hand side is nothing but PXY, which is a pre-processed output. Okay, and this is what my raw images is. So FXY will have some element. On top of it, we will use something as an operator. So some operation will do on top of this raw image, so that this pre-processed output is somehow smoothened. Okay, so in order to explain that, okay, there are many methods of doing it. So let us explain one or two methods, so that at least you have an idea about how we are doing it. And one such method is called as the neighborhood averaging method. Okay, I think, I don't know whether you know it. How many of you know neighborhood averaging method? Okay, just to give you a glimpse of how we are doing it. Okay, so it's neighborhood averaging method. Okay, so what we do is, so remember, this is what, suppose the image is, or we call this as f of xy. Okay, so remember, in masking, what we are trying to do is, we are trying to make sure that raw image, whatever we have received, to smoothen the whole image. So what we are doing is, we are, suppose we have an image of this nature, 20, 30, 40, 20, 10, 30, 40, 30, 40, 10, 20, like that it goes on. Okay. So just we are focusing on a specific segment of the image. So this is what the image is looking at. So this is nothing but the f of xy. And all those elements, 10, 20, 30, this is all what you are looking at, ix, I00 or I01, like that elements. Okay. So this is the frame grabbing part. Now what we are going to do is, as we all know, that t of x, y is nothing but some kind of an operation on top of x, y. So this is the principle. In neighborhood averaging method, what we are going to do is something like this. T x, y is given by 1 by r summation n, n for all values of s, I'll explain everything, f of n, n. This is what the formula is for neighborhood averaging. Forget about the formula, I'll just explain you how it is done. That is more important to us. Please concentrate on this. So what is s? S is set of pixel. Any doubt? Why? Please see this. Okay, set of pixel lying in the neighborhood of x, y. Okay, so this is what the S indicates. N and M is naturally the number of pixel, as we have already mentioned. And R, this R, is nothing but the total number of total number of neighborhood pixels. Just write it down first, we'll explain with the diagram itself how it is done. So this is a formula and this is ideally the process involved. Now see what we are trying to achieve over here. Now suppose we are considering this 20, this 30. Please see this. We are considering this mark 30. We are trying to find out whether that 30 is actually a 30 value of the pixel. As I told you, this is the one diagram, this one, this is the raw image. Okay, this is the raw value of the image. So you want to smoothen the whole thing. So our reference value is the circled one, 30. So what we are going to do is, we are going to take the neighborhood elements and we will just sum it up. For example, in this case, if I consider this half only, why we are taking this 3 cross 3? Because this is a standard template of image processing where the template or the portion of the image that we have to take one by one, we cannot take the whole image, we have to segregate that into specific segments. The segments will usually has a standard of 3 cross 3. So that boxed area, considering the middle one is the reference point, is the point of our reference. Please understand why I am doing this. This is a 3 cross 3 matrix. Within the frame grabbed, we will go on taking 3 cross 3 segment of the image. And within which, one of the center element is the point of our reference. Okay. Now, let us just focus on this. I just zoom on this. So, 10, only the segment part, 10, 20, 30, 40, 10, 30, 40, 40, 10 and 20. So, this is the 3 cross 3 segment of this element. So, I have just made this right over here. Okay. Now, this is my reference. Now, see what I am doing. Set of pixels lying. So, S is nothing but set of pixels lying in the neighborhood of X. So, the lying elements are 20, 30, 40, 10, even include the element that we are talking about, 30, you have 40, another 40, 10 and 20. So, these are all the elements, considering the 30 element is the reference. Then, as per the formula as it indicates, is basically a summation. So, what we are going to do is, we will just add up. We are going to add up this and the whole thing to be divided by, this is in the formula is given as R. So, R is the total number of neighborhood elements. So, the total number of neighborhood element is nothing but 9. So, because it's a 3 cross 3, so divided by 9 and this will give us something value of 26.66. So, what does that mean? That the 30 that is being referred over here has an ideal value after the processing is around 26.6. I am again repeating once again, the frame grabbing or the portion that we are talking about, these are the raw captured image. Now what we have to do is we have to process a little bit. So in that case, one of the method is neighborhood averaging, in which what we are taking one of the pixel as our reference and we are adding up all the elements neighbor to it. And divide by the, and in including the element that we are referring to, in fact, and then divide by the total number of elements, which always will be 9 in this case, because we are taking a 3 cross 3 template. And thus we are getting something as 26.6, and that 26.6 indicates that instead of this 30, the value should have been 26.6. Now it will go on for all these pixel values. This whole process will undergo, and each and every element will be shifted a little bit from their original value. So, that will indicate that what is the exact value or the optimal value of each of these pixels. So, that is something, some kind of an image processing or the operation that we are talking about, because this is all in terms of this operation. This is a neighborhood averaging that we are doing on top of the f of x value. Okay. Similarly, we have something called as, we have something called as median filtering. Median filtering. This is also pretty simple. Okay. Again, you will take care of the same element and suppose you are considering a frame of this nature. So, 10, 20, 30, 40, 20, 10, 30, 40, 30, 40, 10, 20, like that it will go on. And suppose I have a reference, or the reference value is this 10. I want to check this 10. Same neighborhood averaging also can be applied, but this is a different method that is called as a median filtering. What usually is made, or what usually is considered, that we will again take a 3 cross 3 template. So that means we are going to segregate out something like this. This portion. Again, it is a 3 cross 3. Now, within this 3 cross 3, we are going to sort all the elements. This is where the difference is. We will sort all the elements. We will not sum it up. So, sorting will indicate that this is the element. So, first we will write the elements. 10, 20, 30, 20, 10, 30, 30, 40 and 10. So, these are all the elements I have mentioned. Now, median filtering indicates that we have to sort these elements. So, sorting means something like, I will write here 10. So, this 10 comes in. Another 10 is here. So, 10. Another 10 is here. 10. Then we have a 20 here. 20. Another 20. 20. 30. 30. This 30. 30. Another 30. And we have a 40. So, these are the total elements that is present after sorting. Now, the process is that if this is a 3 cross 3, so there are 9 elements. If there are 9 elements, so n by 2 floor function, okay, n by 2, n here indicates the number of elements within the template. So, total 9 elements, so 9 by 2 is 4.5. Floor function of a 4.5 is 4, okay. So, n by 2, if n is even, rather I would write this way, if n is odd, then the floor function of it we have to consider, and we have to discard that many element of pixel from the result. Meaning, if n is equal to 9, why is n equal to 9? Because we have considered 3 cross 3, so total 9 elements. So, 9 by 2 is 4.5, floor function is 4. So, what we have to do is, we have to discard all these 4 elements, 1, 2, 3, 4, from the front, and from the back also we have to segregate or remove 4 elements. So, 1, 2, 3, 4. So, whatever we are left with, this 20, is ideally the optimized pixel value with respect to this 10 which is mentioned here. I'm again mentioning it once again. This is all the process involving masking. In masking, what we are doing is, we are trying to generate a pre-processed output based on some operation on the raw data. Now, one of the operation is the neighborhood averaging, as I told you. The second method that, there are many methods, the second method that we are discussing is median filtering, in which what we are trying to do is, if one is a reference, we are going to sort all the elements to neighbor of that element. From the sorting, if the total number of elements are odd, we are going to make sure that there is, say, the element, the floor function is used for n by 2. And from that, whatever the calculated value, we are going to discard that many elements from the first half or the beginning of the series and the end of the series. Okay, so that's whatever we are left with, that is the reference value or the optimized value with respect to the element that we are choosing. So, this is another method of doing a process. Now, based on the efficiency and calculation, naturally there are many other processes, so it can go on. But these are the two, just to give you an understanding on how this masking process is in. So, let us go back to the presentation. So, this is what the masking is all about for us. Now, next is, so remember, all this we are doing, trying to make sure that there is some kind of a filtering or some polishing of the raw image. Okay. Now, based on that, if that is done, now we have to make sure that there is a image data reduction. In order to do that, the best way of doing it is to capture the RGB image or the color image and to convert that to grayscale. But again, with grayscale, it is too many number of bits that is usually used. So, we have to convert that to black and white image. Because if I consider the black and white image, basically we are using a ones or zeros. So, hence the total number of bits are reduced drastically. And hence the size of the image, I will show you a MATLAB program itself, now we are going to do, where we will prove that how the size of the image is reduced. So, basically that is what we are doing. We will just check with a numerical, in fact. I think I have one numerical, we will directly go there. So let's see how this numerical helps us in understanding the gray level tool. So the question is, for an image of size 128 x 128, this is what the pixel size we are talking about. Using an 8-bit A2D, determine the total number of bits to represent the gray level. Okay, so as far as the gray level is concerned, simply what we are going to do is, we are going to do something like this. So please make a note of this question. So it's an 8-bit register. Okay. So the gray level will be nothing but, as we have discussed even in optical encoding in fact, that it will be something like 2 to the power 8. So there will be 256. This is the gray, 256 gray levels present. Now if you have the total number of bits, okay, so this is the total size of the image, and you have this many number of levels we have. So total number of bits for a gray level, that is nothing but 128 cross 128 multiplied by 256 level, and this is nothing but, it's a huge number, 419 4304. So this many number of bits is required. It's a significant problem. That's why I'm specifically mentioning that data. So you can observe that if it is a gray level, this many number of bits is required. Now, as I told you, this is all part of data reduction. So we have to reduce. So what we are going to do is, this gray level, we are going to convert that to binary values. So if it is a binary data, so total number of bits for the binary image, because that's the second part of the story. So the dimension remains as it is, but here there is only two state that is possible, either 1 or a 0. So basically we are multiplying that by 2. So this is coming around 16384 bits. So now you can observe that if I consider a gray level calculation, okay, if I consider a gray level calculation over here, this many number of bits, whereas for a bit, if I convert to black and white image, it is coming around that 16,000 odd data. Now if you check the efficiency, you will find that around 99% of the data has been reduced in this case. We can prove that in the MATLAB. Yeah, please. 8-bit, yeah, A2D. This is 8-bit A2D converter we are talking about. I'm multiplying it by the number of levels in this case. Because here also I'm multiplying by the number of levels. Levels means in this case is how you can spread the level. Like for, suppose it's a binary image, it's a 1 and 0. So it's basically black or white. So the level of information for that image is basically 2. That's how the level is. So if this is an 8-bit, suppose it was a 4-bit register, then 2 to the power 4 will be the number of levels of gray level image. That's how. So this level and all I cannot really go beyond, because this is the image processing part of the story. So I am multiplying the image with the number of levels that it can spread on. That is something, an idea. So you can see that in this case, if I go on calculating, it is around 99% saving of the data. So that is somehow, this is some method of reducing the image size, because this is discussed with respect to image data reduction. So after I capture the image, okay, I am processing it, pre-processing it using the masking technique that I told you. Then after that, we are trying to reduce the size of the image as well. After it is done, we are going for something called as windowing technique. Now why windowing technique? Because windowing involves using a portion of the image. Now if you have a big image, or if you have a very large set of image, and you are segregating out into smaller pixel, because whole of the image is not at all providing us the information. It's only a specific segment of the image. If I capture and we process, we can find out a lot of information about the image itself. Okay? So you can see, for example, an inspection of a printed circuit board, on one wish to inspect and analyze only one component on the board. So that is where the windowing technique comes in. We'll see that how it is done. Thresholding is one of the quickest method of doing it. And a rectangular window is selected to surround the components of interest, and only one pixel within the windows are analyzed. Okay, only one pixel within the, and so this is a technique in which a portion of the image has been stored. So remember, if it's a very high, heavy, data heavy image, we have reduced the size. Even we are reducing it for our processing by taking only a portion of the image. So that is how the processing, because we are discussing all with respect to image processing for that matter. So what we are going to do is, we are having three type of segmentation. Now after the windowing is done, the segmentation is the objective is to group areas of an image having similar characteristics or features. And that is being done using these techniques of thresholding, region growing and edge detection. These are all there in our syllabus in fact. So thresholding is a very nice technique in fact, where we will keep a threshold like this. You can see here what the idea is. There will be some kind of a threshold being made. This I will explain you with a MATLAB program itself so that you can understand. So you have this h of x, see this p of xy is again that pre-processed output after the masking has happened. So p of xy is there. Now I will put some threshold th. Now if the pre-processed output is greater than the threshold or less than the threshold, we will either select 1 or 0 and hence we will generate a black and white image from the RGB image or the gray images. So that is what the idea is. It is a process to obtain a clear distinction between the objects and its background. Okay, to clearly identify, because you just visualize that when a manipulator has this, a robot has this as a camera or the, like a CCD sensor, it is detecting the object, now it has to segregate the background with respect to this object. So that is where it comes in handy. So binary images reduces the complexity of the data and simplifies the process of recognition and classification. To understand this, let us directly go to a program that I have tried writing so that you can able to understand. So let me just go little bit, take time to understand this. I guess it's visible. So what we are trying to do is, we are reading an image which is an RGB. I guess for image processing people this will be not a much difficulty. So we are reading with a command called imread, which is a very common command in MATLAB. Then what we are trying to do is, we are converting that to gray image so that I can show you the gray image also. So this is imdata RGB to gray. And then what we are trying to do is, we are making a threshold of 150. Okay, we are keeping our threshold of 150. So that is ideally the TH that I mentioned. So after pre-processing, this is to be compared. Okay, so the comparison comes somewhere over here. You can see, this is the comparison. So if it is greater than threshold, we will consider it to be 1. If it is less than threshold, else it is 0. Simple as that. Nothing more than that. And after that, I am trying to plot everything over here, right over here, okay, based on the output. So let's see how it happens. So if I run this, okay, so this is primarily the process of involved in case of image processing. Suppose the robot has captured this image. Now it will convert that to a grayscale image, something of this nature. Now the last one, as you can observe, as I was trying to point out, the last image, okay, this has only black and white. And as far as the size is concerned, this will also reduce drastically. To check that, so this is basically the thresholding method. By thresholding, by keeping that 150 as a threshold, we are getting this. Now you go on changing the threshold, you will get a different set of answers for this. Okay, so you will get a clarity, more clearer, crisper image. Along with that, you resize the image also. IM resize is one of the commands in MATLAB. You can use that, you can resize the image as well. But to check that whether it's true or not, what we are going to do is, let me just do one thing. This IM, this threshold that you're looking at, this is the black and white image. So what I'm going to do is, I'll separately, so this is the black and white image, okay? So what I'm going to do is, I'm saving it. So save as, why I'm saving it, I'll tell you. So we have this. So this is the, okay, now, Now check here. So this is, okay, original image is this one, okay, and it has a size of 599 KB. If I just happens to go to properties, so around 599 KB is the size. Now after conversion, this is the X value. This is now I saved it. If I go here and go to its property, it's coming around 19 KB. See here, 19 KB. So the same image has reduced its size. So this is what the idea behind image data reduction, as well as making a thresholding to work. Understand? So the image that has been captured is now making sure that the same image is there, but it has been processed. Naturally, after processing, we will convert back to RGB once again. The same process, the other way around. But the processing requires less space. That is what is important in this case. Clear? So let us go back to our discussion. So that is what I was trying to figure out here. And this is the graph again. I wanted to show you. This is already I shown you with the MATLAB code. So that's how the thresholding works. The next method is in fact pretty interesting, that after we have done this thresholding, or this is as it comes under the segmentation process itself, there is another method of doing a segmentation, and that is called as region growing method. To understand this, let us not discuss anything on this theory. Let us directly go to something of this nature. Why we are doing it, let's check. Okay, let's check this thing now. Now, in the process of region growing, what it indicates, let us just write it down once. So, in region growing, maybe I'll just show you one here. Just a one or two lines. One is one something called as seed point. Seed point is a starting point. Okay, from all the pixel, all the pre-processed output, after the pre-processed output, you have to take any one single point to start. And that is what the seed point is. It should be near to the maximum pixel value. Okay. For example, if I go back here, 6 is considered to be the seed point. Why? Because the maximum pixel size is 7. This is just an intuitive understanding. Just see what I'm doing. So 6 is a seed point. So for a region growing method, I require a seed point or a starting point. Another thing I require is called as a threshold. What is a threshold? Threshold can be any point, but it should be somewhere in between the least and the maximum points. So the least point in this case is 0 and the maximum point is here is 7. So we will take somewhere in between. It could have been 4 or we have taken in this case as 3. Okay. So we will just write it over here. So I will write over here. So the threshold point is 3 and the seed point or the starting point is 6. It can be anything. If you check for other values, it will be different. But this is for my reference. Now the process is for region growing is something like this. Like I'll check this seed point and I'll compare this point with the other neighboring points. Okay. And if the difference is greater than the threshold, I'll segregate or segment that into one region. And if it is less than the threshold, I'll segregate into different region. For example, 6 is compared to 2. The difference is 4. 4 is greater than the threshold. Because threshold is 3. I'm repeating once again. 6 is my seed point. I'm comparing it with this 2. 6 minus 2 difference is 4. 4 is greater than the threshold. Hence, the condition A is satisfied. So I have mentioned A over here. That is one of the point. Similarly, I'll compare it with 5. 6 minus 5 is 1. 1 is less than the threshold. Okay. So it should have been 1 is less than the threshold. So this is 6 minus 4 6 minus 2 is 4. So it would have been A. Oh, sorry. What I have not defined A and B. So let me just write it down here somewhere. I mentioned it. So A and B, what is A and B? I'll just mention somewhere here. So P of X comma Y, okay, let me just write it over here maybe. I have that, I'll do it here. So let me write it over here. So P of X comma Y, if it is greater than threshold, this will be A,
And P of x comma y, if it is less than threshold, it should be B. B is two segment, two different output. So let me just take this as one example. I think this will be clearer to you. 5, 6, 7, 8, 4, 3, 2, 6, 0, 1, 0, 0, 2, 5, 4, and 7. Suppose this is the image. I'm just making a smaller aspect to it. Now the seed point is 6 once again. Suppose I take 6 seed point as 6 and threshold as 3. Now let us check one by one what is happening. So my seed point is, so this is suppose the seed point of 6 maybe. So I'll start from this point. It could have been this one as well. So 6 minus 5, 6 minus 5 is 1. Okay, so 1 is less than the threshold. So I'll consider this. So PXY is less than threshold. So we'll consider it to be B. Okay. Similarly, we'll consider this to be 6 minus 4 is 2, which is B. 6 minus 0 is again greater than C. So this will be A. 6 minus 0 is greater than this, so A. 6 minus 3. So now 6 minus 3 is 3. Now, since we have not made it equal to threshold, so we will consider this to be less. It's not equal, okay? So, less than that. So, for a condition like this, 6 minus 3, we will consider it to be A or B for that matter. We can take any one. This is what the problem with region growing, in fact. 6 minus 1, so again 4, 4 is greater than this. So, we have A. 6 minus 0 is again A. 6 minus 7 is B. 6 minus 2 is B, 6 minus 2 is B, 6 minus 4 is 2, which is A, 6 minus 8 is 2, which is again B, 6 minus 6 is 0, which is again less than that, so B, 6 minus 5 is 1, which is B, 6 minus 7 is 1, which is B. Okay, so like that, we are segregated. Now, the region growing process is, this is all under the segmentation. All the B's should be considered in a single segment. So maybe we will mark this way. So maybe we will mark this way. B is here. Okay, so this is one segment. We have this as one segment. So clearly, this also should be included in fact. So clearly you can indicate, so the rest of the things, whatever is there, is all about A. So this all, if I consider this to be a shaded region, suppose this one I am doing. So the middle portion is basically the A region. So this is one region. And this is another region, second region. So if you can closely observe, what we are trying to do is, from the pixel size, we are making sure that we are segregating it into two different regions. That is why it is called as region growing method. So, we are generating these two regions to segregate the individual regions. Okay. Now, the problem with this is, as you can observe, that if the threshold is not kept properly, this type of a scenario will come in. Where you can observe that this B or this A is separated somewhere out. Okay. It would have been a much clearer distinction if we could have taken a threshold as 4. Or maybe we could have taken the seed point as maybe 5. Okay, so that is the problem. So region growing method has a basic problem that the seed point calculation or consideration of the seed point happens to be an issue. So I'll go back to this. So what are the solution to it? So this is again another example of it. So we already had discussed this one. So the pros and cons, the cons is more important that seed point must be specified. We have to eliminate the seed point concept somehow. And that is where the region split and merge method comes in. This is very, very simple. We don't have that much of a difficulty in understanding this. And this has region splitting and region merging, merging process. Now let us discuss on the splitting part first. So let's see whether we can understand this. So this is the overall pixel size. In case of, this is intuitive from the diagram itself, how we are going to do is, we are going to split the image. We don't need any seed point, nothing. We just will go on splitting the whole image into equal halves.
Just you can observe here, the orange one, the first state, the red one or orange one, what you are looking at. So the first thing is this cross. Okay.
So this one, this part, the orange that you are looking at, this is the first of the segment. So equally we have divided. Now, within those small segments, we are going to find the maximum and the minimum points. See here. So for this A segment, check this A segment. A segment is here. So we are going to check the maximum, which is 7, and the minimum, which is 4. Now we will check that whether maximum minus minimum is less than or equal to the threshold considered. So again, we have considered threshold as 3. Threshold is there. Threshold should be there. Otherwise, we cannot segregate, in fact. So in this case, the threshold is considered to be 3, and we are considering the individual block and their maximum and minimum. Okay. Now we are dividing it. So you can see that 7 minus 5, or 7 minus, for that matter, 7 minus 5 is 2. Now 2 is less than 3. Okay. So it is okay. We are not going to segregate anything. So it is kept as it is. Now you can see 7 minus 6 is 1. So it is 1, 1 is less than 3, so we are keeping it. So you can observe that within this A, there exists no other element which is greater than 3. So there is no need of segregating this one further. But if you closely observe this half, the right hand half of it, the maximum is 7. See here, 7. And the minimum is here, 5. Minimum is 2. Yeah, minimum is 2. So the difference is 7 minus 2, which is eventually 5, which is greater than the threshold. So at least there are elements where the condition is not met. Hence, this needs to be splitted once again. So wherever we will go on splitting up this whole process as and when required, if the condition is not met. So this is being explained over here. If you can observe, the region growing starts from regions, this is region growing. Regions or alternative start to an image is region, subdivide the region that do not satisfy the condition of homogeneity. And in this case, you can observe that what we are trying to do is we are going on segregating it. And now if you observe this C part, this is a segment of the bigger half. Now you can see maximum is 7, minimum is 5, 7 minus 5 is 2, 2 is less than 3. So you need to separate out, or you don't need to segregate out there. You check this D1, highest is 7, minimum is 4, 7 minus 4 is 3, 3 is less than or equal to threshold condition, I don't need to segregate this out. Similarly, it goes on. Now, the merging process is, I think we can't do it today. Merging, what will happen? We will go on merging the elements which are on the same, which doesn't require a split up. So basically, what we are going to do is A and C and D, all this forms a single segmented element. I think I have a diagram for that. Yeah, something like this. Okay, so this is basically the merging process. After you do for all the points, basically you can see there is a clear distinction of the two elements. The pink one is indicating one example. Now suppose this pink one that is indicating, this is a black background. From image point of view, this is a black background. And this is what this part is, the butterfly that we were looking at. So our robotic vision will, or the machine vision will be such that it will segregate out this butterfly from the background image of black or white for that matter, whatever it is. So this is why how the segmentation work for region growing or the region split and merge method. This merging, this happens because of those individual elements, this individual parts. For example, A is merged with C, this is merged with D, then it goes like this, it goes like this, it goes like this. So this whole A, C, D, F, H, J. Okay, this whole segment is actually a single element. And the rest of the things will be of the single other element. So like that it goes on making the segmentation like this. Maybe we'll start from this next class. I'll just explain this a little bit more. And then we'll finish off with the S next.